Welcome to Punchline Talks, the big interview, and sponsored by Infostar IT Solutions. My name is Mark Owen, and today my special guest is Dame Janet Trotter. She's awarded an OBE, promoted to a DBE, a CVO. She is also chair of the Cyber Trust, chair of the Chamwell Centre, chair of the Nelson's Trust. In 2010, she was appointed Lord Lieutenant of Gloucestershire, and she finished in that role in 2018. She joins me today. Hello, Janet, Dame Janet.
Hello, Mark, and do call me Janet.
Well, thank you very much indeed. It's lovely to see you. Thanks for joining us today. Okay, obviously I've known you for quite some time, but let's start with you becoming Lord Chancellor, Vice Chancellor of the University of Gloucestershire and starting the university. How did that come about?
I need to go back a bit because I first came to be principal of the College of St Paul and St Mary, which was located in Cheltenham, and it was doing mainly teacher training, and that was in 1986. I'd hardly been here any time at all when I was asked if I would try and get half of GLOSCAT, the higher education courses, and the College of Paul and Mary together, because there was a sense in government that higher education should be stronger in Gloucestershire. So we went through a merger process, which was actually very complicated and difficult. And then we worked as the Cheltenham and Gloucester College of Higher Education until 2002, when we'd gone through all of the hurdles and hoops, and we were made a university.
What was the most difficult part of doing that?
Oh,
I mean, you've got to bring everybody. The thing about it, you know, and what I always think you're very good at is obviously bringing everybody along for the ride, you know, and inspiring people. But what was, you know, because you've got a lot of people, it's like a huge jigsaw you've got to put into place. What was the most difficult part of that?
It was very complex, and it depends on which audiences you're talking about, because in 1986, when I first came, we had too many buildings, and we went out with a plan for how we were going to handle these buildings and sell some, build up others. And the whole of the local population was up in arms saying, we don't want more students in our backyard. So that was one element that was very difficult to handle. Then at the point of the merger, which is 1990, GLOSCAT was a local authority college and the College of Paul and Mary was a church college. They'd tried before to get together and hadn't. So there was a long legacy of mistrust, not liking one another. And therefore, the task of getting that together was extremely complex, because you were dealing with different academic groups, the local authority, the Church of England, and so on. And then university title was difficult, because I think it was 1992 when we got an element of university title. The government changed the rules, and then various people outside the organization were saying, you'll never get a university title, you know, what do you think you're doing? And the amazing thing at that time was that the internal audience, people inside the college, felt that this was a mission that we needed to go about. So they became absolutely committed to this vision of Gloucestershire having its own university. So we worked very, very hard and well inside. But the external environment was very difficult, because people were forever commenting that we'd never get university title. What did we really think we were doing? Gloucestershire didn't really need something like this. So depending on the sort of thing that we were about, depended on the audience, where there was an adverse reaction that needed to be handled.
So why? How can there's still a Gloucester College then, and with a university that's spun out of Gloscom?
Well, I'm going back into ancient history and long before my time. But in the 1960s, when polytechnics were created, there was a thought that Gloucestershire should have a polytechnic, and a strong polytechnic. So in the late 60s, early 70s, Gloucestershire College, which was higher education and further education, and the College of Paul and Mary, had plans to come together. And they even got as far as appointing a principal and giving him an office. And then just weeks before the merger was supposed to take place, it all fell apart. So Glosscat, as you will remember it, continued doing both higher education and further education, and the College of Paul and Mary carried on its own sweet way. And then it was 1988 that I came on the scene, and I was told that really the sensible thing was to get all of the higher education together and to make it as strong as possible, and to let the further education reside in one college, where further education, very important area, was its business.
So how did you become the actual principal itself then?
How did I?
How did you end up becoming the vice principal of the university? So you put the two together. It was a bit of a coup, was it, or something? In locked out everybody. Boxing or pistols at dawn or something?
No, the interesting thing was that I was in Lancaster and had only just moved to Lancaster to be vice principal when someone rang me up in 1986, the chairman of governors, and said, why haven't you applied for this job as principal of Paul and Mary in Cheltenham? So I said, well, I've only just moved here. I really don't want to move and I'm very happy and so on. And he said, I'll meet you anytime, anywhere, any place, but please apply. So I said, no, don't, I don't want to go down that route. Anyway, after about the fifth time of him asking, I met him on a Saturday evening. And then I was invited on the back of a 20-minute interview to come to Paul and Mary. And then when the merger took place, the principal of Glosscat, so the chap who'd been appointed earlier, said that he wanted to retire. So I was the single person in post. And the governor said, I think we'll go out for public advertisement to test you against the market. And I said, well, you know, I don't think I'll bother to apply for that. And they interviewed me as the sole candidate and then offered me the job.
Woo-hoo. So you became vice principal. What year was that again, sorry?
I became principal of the College of Cheltenham Gloucester College in 1990.
Okay, and the university then?
Was designated in 2002.
Right, okay. So what was it like there the early days? Because obviously we see it now, here we are in 2024 with all the different campuses. How many students did you have? How many staff did you have? What sort of budget were we looking at?
Well, it was the early days were very interesting because the only way you'll get an academic institution to work well is to draw academic staff around a vision of the academic potential and opportunities. So we decided to go for a modular scheme and drew all sorts of talent from across Glosscat and Paul and Mary together. And we had a really exciting academic offering. So students started to tumble in and it was all very exciting. But at the same time, the finances weren't very good. So I think the budget was about 32 million or 35 million around that. And I went off for Christmas in the first year with some figures thinking I'm not very happy about what my waters are telling me about the finances. And then came to the conclusion that we were heading for a £16 million deficit if we didn't do something quickly. So when I came back, there was a sort of, I don't like to call it this really, but the night of the long knives when we had to really take hold of the institution and shape it and its systems around, you know, a very tight administrative system.
And I would imagine that didn't make you very popular.
No, and I suppose this is the thing, you have to, and this sounds horrible, but as a principal, you're there to look after the whole institution. And if it's right for the whole institution to go on and you've got a compelling vision for the whole institution in its context, then you sometimes do have to sacrifice some people. And that's, I found that very hard and very difficult to do. But I can remember one of the first thoughts I had when I came to Cheltenham, and I looked out over the staff. What were there, 150 staff and about 1,500 students? This was in 1986. And I thought every one in this room of staff depends on me and the senior team making the right decisions to be able to support their families, be able to support their mortgages. And that sharpens you up in terms of what decisions you make and making sure that you are, you know, fit and healthy and you sleep well and you eat well, all these other things, so that you're in a right position and your head is in the right position to make good decisions on behalf of the organisation, because everyone relies on you to do that.
I mean, basically, you're the chief executive of the company, aren't you?
Absolutely.
That's basically what it is. And, you know, and I this is what I like about these interviews, you know, because we all live in an environment we're going to make money. You know, you have to hire people. And unfortunately, you have to fire people. It comes in the joy, doesn't it? And I think it's the firing people is the most difficult part of the job.
I think it is. And however much you say, I'm going to do it nicely, you know, it's not always received nicely. And those are very difficult messages to give to staff.
Okay, so you became the principal and vice principal, and the college started, university started to grow. You managed to sort out the money then. And, you know, when did that happen? When did it sort of, did you, you know, make it okay?
By about 1995, we were still Cheltenham Gloucester College of Higher Education at that point, and we were recognised as a very smart, forward-thinking college, and you know, ahead of the pack in that area. And we were the first college to become a university under those rules, and it was very, very tough to get through the hoops and hurdles.
I was going to say, what was the toughest part of it all?
Making sure that people are not imaginative with the processes and procedures that they've got to follow.
You're trying to say they've got to follow the processes.
They've got to follow the processes, and particularly in terms of quality assurance, what the rights of students are, what students have a right to expect from a university, in terms of, you know, academic tuition, et cetera, et cetera. And, you know, that's quite tough to instill right across the whole organisation.
So when did you actually step down, and how did the university look at that particular point?
I stepped down in 2006 when I'd done 20 years, which some people would say was a long time. Some others people would say was too long. It was in, I think it was in reasonable health at that point, but it was, I felt quite strongly in my own bones that it was right for someone to come in and take on the next stage of reshaping the organisation and setting the new strategy. So that's why I did it then. I mean, I wasn't lacking commitment. I just felt it was the right time for everybody.
And what buildings did you have at that particular point?
What
buildings did you have at that particular point when you finally left?
We had Oxtores, which had just got an outstanding award for the best and most sustainable building built in the UK in 2002. And we were very much on the green agenda before most other people were. So we were in Gloucester, and we were in various buildings in Cheltenham.
Right. Okay. So what did you do when you left? Because suddenly the idea was to retire, or you know, hang up your hat, or, you know, how did you suddenly get into all these other things, really? You know, become the chair of this, and don't mind me saying, wearing lots of hats? Do they suddenly, you get offered lots of hats because you're a doer?
I've always had lots of hats. So when I was at the university, I did a lot of other things. So I chaired the NHS organisation. I chaired the Hospitals Trust. I was at meetings in London and so on. So it's not, and did a lot of things for the Church of England. So that's not a change for me. I merely put one big hat down and pick up some others. And I've got a view that if anybody wants me to do anything, I ought to think about doing it. So that's how it is. I don't go out and seek work. It sort of comes to me.
Well, obviously, your reputation precedes you, doesn't it? I mean, that's the thing. You're a person who gets things done, and that's why people come to you, I would imagine. So you can you tell me about how you became Lord Lieutenant? And what year was that?
2010. So when I left the university, I did a number of things, but the main role I had was as chair of the NHS Trust in Gloucestershire, which had actually just merged in 2002. So that was a big commitment, trying to get more cohesion between Cheltenham and Gloucester in terms of health services and so on. So quite a big job. And there again, I did some things in London and locally. And then in 2010, Sir Henry Arwes was retiring, and as Lord Lieutenant, you have to retire at 75. And I nowhere thought that I would be asked to be Lord Lieutenant, but I got a letter through the post saying, we'd like you to become Lord of Lieutenant. And that was pretty well it.
And what's the most enjoyable part of that role? I mean, you did it a long time, 10 years.
For me, but this is a recurring theme, I'm interested in the sort of big picture stuff and people who are clearly significant in society. But I'm much more interested in meeting Mrs. Bloggs, who's doing, you know, a great job in her community and does it year by year by year. And one of the things at the hospital I really liked doing was doing the volunteer awards every year. And I can remember quite a few dear people coming up, and they didn't know whether to curtsy to me or to bow or to get on their knees. And I always felt I wanted to lift them up because they were the people doing great work in their community and in the hospital. So I think I'm not fazed by people who appear to be important. I'm more interested in the heroes in a local community. And I would hope, actually, that I'm a sort of hero in a local community context. So I do my bit. I give my energy, I give my time, and I do my bit for my local community and in terms of building it up. And you know, it was nice to do royal visits. I learned a lot from doing royal visits, but that's not the thing that I think I excelled in. I think I excelled in trying to value local people in their communities doing really impressive things.
You've touched on the royals now, so I'll ask you. I mean, you obviously met the Queen quite a few times, I would imagine.
Yeah.
What was your number one take from a royal visit?
Well, I was at a royal visit about a week ago. But I'm on the board of Great Western Railway. So last Thursday, I was standing on platform 10 of Great Western Railway, Paddington, and the Princess Royal came to have a train named after her. And she got up and she met people and so on. And actually, what I took out of that, which I take out of most royal visits, is just how professional the royal family are. So she'd done her preparation. She was just charming to everybody. And I was with apprentices and train managers and hosts and so on. And without fear or favour, it doesn't matter whether you've got a title or not, she's absolutely consistently there for the people she meets. And I think that, again, valuing people and being a consummate professional is what I take out of royal visits.
Well, let's go back to the very beginning of Vets OK. So where are you from, Janet? Are you from Gloucestershire? Are you born here? Or...
No. I was born in Chatham, in Kent.
Wow, it's a long way from home. What did your parents do?
My father was in the police, and he was called up in 1941, which is why they were in Chatham, because he was called up into the army, and my parents were stationed in Chatham. And my mother was a servant in service, let me put it that way, in a big house. So it was like Downton Abbey. When I see Downton Abbey, it's just like talking to my mother about, you know, what goes on below stairs.
And were you always interested in academia? Were you a bright kid?
Oh no. No, no, no. I was thick. What people did pick out about me very early on was the fact that I organised things. So one of my primary school teachers said to my mother, if I wasn't here, Janet would organise the class. So that was clearly there. But no, I wasn't. I mean, I was in a class, we'd moved by this time, but I was in a class of 31 children, and only two did not get into the grammar school. And I was one of those. So I was an 11 plus failure. I got the 13 plus, which means that I was designated as technical, and went to a technical school. And it was there that I suddenly got a love of learning. And the world opened up to me in a way that it hadn't before. And it's strange that I only recently, just as I was finishing as Lord Lieutenant, got a letter from my teacher who taught me religious studies at that time. And she took me through in some detail the fact that she went to the head and said that she thought I ought to go to university. And the head said, Janet Trotter, go to university? Of course she can't, she's not bright enough. So even in my secondary education, I was not seen as very bright or outstanding. And I guess since then, I've been motivated by just learning, trying to do the best I can, and being interested in the world and in people.
Do you tend to read novels a lot, or do you tend to read the newspapers, or are you like me, you read kind of everything?
I read everything.
Yeah. Is there a particular area that you're really interested in? You know, I know you're part of the cyber stuff now. Does that still interest you, or engineering, or?
Not particularly, although I am in a novel, cyber strike novel, and I'm M, I think, or their equivalent of M in this thing. But no, I read eclectically. I mean, I'm reading a book at the moment called Empireland, which is all about the impact, for good or ill, of the British Empire throughout the world by Satnam Sangera, who I recently heard at the Gloucestershire Festival. Gloucester Festival. And I'm interested in that, but I'm also interested in another book, which is called Book Thief, which is about the Holocaust and so on. So, and I also like crime novels. So some of them are too gory for me. So I like things like Inspector Morse and things like that, and nothing that's too violent or complicated.
So how did you get from going to university? Where did you go to university to get to Gloucestershire in around a couple of minutes?
Well, strangely enough, I didn't. So I'm a mess of contradictions. So I didn't go to university, and always found it strange that I ended up running a university. But my father, who did not particularly agree with women's education, didn't want me to loaf around at a university. So I went off to college to teach. And I taught in Kent for 8 years, a range of pupils from kids with special education needs to grammar school, Oxbridge entrance, and so on. And then I was being pushed towards management roles, and I decided I didn't really want management at that point. So I took a sideways step into colleges and then just kept being promoted and never left colleges, although I always thought that I would. So that's the route.
Well, we and did you obviously you never thought you'd ever get to what you've done or what you've achieved. What would you say was the number one lesson, you know, for your journey?
Well, one of the big lessons for me is nobody is perfect. No one person is perfect, but a team might be. And I think if I look back on my life cycle, I've worked with some absolutely fantastic teams of people. And I think being team leader and drawing out the skills and the talents of different people in the team so that they can contribute to the whole endeavor is quite a skill. So that's one of the things that I think is very important.
Well, I know you're a very busy person. You obviously read a lot. But what other hobbies have you got, Janet?
Hobbies. I like walking, and I like music. So if you're asking me, so I'm reading, and a bit of gardening probably thrown in.
Okay. And if you've got something in your car, what sort of music do you have in your car? I imagine you sitting there classical and
classic FM.
I could have guessed that. Well, we're kind of running out of time already, unfortunately.
Oh goodness.
So I've got to ask you for your top three business tips. What would those be, please?
Well, one is the importance of team, and just building teams that are diverse and that are challenging, because that every organisation needs challenge of the senior people and needs a team of talent working together. I think. Another issue that we've touched on, Mark, is about organisations are quite hierarchical. And one of the things you have to get used to is learning about the organisation and its diplomacy or its rules and its regulations, because every organisation has its own unique characteristics. And I think in all of that, a leader, and I'm taking it as a leader and business tips, you have to be humble. You have to try to listen as hard as you can to everybody in the organization. And I used to go in early at the college and always enjoyed talking to my cleaner, who told me more about the organization than I knew. And that's important. I still, of all the people at the university, I still meet my cleaner for coffee periodically. And that's important. And she's like my sort of Cheltenham mother, really. A third one might be always look at the bottom line. Finance is important. So whatever nice people things you have going on. And I think if I could have a fourth, I was very comforted when someone who was a director at ICI said to me, don't think of every day as making big, big decisions. What you do is make series of small decisions, and each of your small decisions you've got to make come right. And that takes some of the strain off thinking, you know, what are the big decisions that I've got to do? There are big decisions in organizations. So if you're going to change your strategy, if you're going to sell a building, if you're going to change the curriculum, but actually when you're a leader, most stuff is about making small decisions and working to make those come right by subsequent actions. And I think that's an important lesson.
Dame Janet Chotter, unfortunately, that's all we've got time for today. Thank you ever so much for joining the big interview. Thank you to our sponsors, Infostar IT Solutions, and thanks for watching the show. Remember, if you like the show, please like, share, subscribe, and we'll see you again next time. It's all in the punchline. Thank you. Bye-bye.